My journey into aviation is, dates back to my childhood altogether. Aviation is one such field that makes you look into the sky. I used to be more interested into air crash investigation series or different documentaries on aviation and engineering in channels like National Geographic Channel, Discovery Channel, Animal Planet, Travel and Living channels. So my aim was to get into piloting after I finished my bachelor's. There was a twist in my fate and I had come across a health issue, and therefore I could not proceed with my class 1 and class 2 medical examination as a pilot, and I could not fly because of it, and that totally hit a very hard blow in my career. And I started writing my book 101 Flying Secrets. It took me a span of 3 months to write. And I have chosen 101 different questions that common people always have about flying in airports. And after having those questions, I started writing the answers for them. Whatever you actually know from my book is something that I have learned in a very strict format of, you know, a lot of theorems, formulas, physics and mathematics. But I have taken that pain and the pleasure of demystifying all of that and all the aviation jargon into simple words. Hello everyone, I'm Rakesh Dhanarapu. I'm a 23 years debutant student author of the book 101 Flying Secrets, which has just been published all across the world. So my journey into aviation is dates back to my childhood altogether. As people, we always look into the skies to look at birds. And next, when we pray to God, we just look up into the sky and pray to God. But apart from that, aviation is one such field that makes you look into the sky. My story starts the similar way. So during the childhood, when many of the students and my peer groups used to watch cartoons and different movies altogether, I used to be more interested into air crash investigation series or different documentaries on aviation and engineering in channels like National Geographic Channel, Discovery Channel, Animal Planet, Travel and Living channels. So my interest started from there. That is when I was introduced to aircrafts. As and when I kept exploring more of these episodes, I started becoming more curious about the technology and the dimensions which aviation actually has. This has slowly got me into a bit of research on the internet and via books. And there was one such stage in my life where I was approaching my 10th standard and I pretty much knew that I need to make a decision about my career. I then slowly advanced into my intermediate stage during my plus one and plus two. I thought for myself that, you know, if there was one thing that I could do the best in my life was aviation. Keeping this interest far-fetched in me from a very long time, I knew that aviation is the field which I need to choose for myself, because I always found myself going back to that subject in terms of research or, you know, involving myself a lot into. And in the same way, my entire course of life in my education after my intermediate, where I've done my MPC, I have written my entrance exams into private universities which only had aviation degrees or aerospace degrees, and I fortunately earned a rank in SRM University, Chennai, and I have done my 4 years bachelor's in aerospace engineering. So my aim was to get into piloting after I finished my bachelor's, and once my bachelor's was over, I was a happy student finishing my bachelor's, and I came back to Hyderabad and I joined Asia Pacific Flight Training Academy. And just between the time when I was migrating from my bachelor's university to APFT Flight Training Academy, there was a twist in my fate and I had come across a health issue. And just to get this health issue sorted before I become a pilot, I went to a doctor, and after all the diagnosis was finished, I was advised to take up a small medical procedure, a small surgery, and which promised me that, you know, I could get back to my piloting with a proper medical fitness. But once the surgery was over, I went back to my Asia Pacific Flight Training Academy, and I was doing my 900 hours ground training for a pilot. And as any pilot would undergo in his training program, he has to undergo a pilot medical fitness program. And for me to clear the medical fitness, I had to produce a documentation from the doctor who operated me for the previous procedure that I am totally cured of the problem. So when I went back to the doctor asking for the clearance of my medical, there were issues that came up, and he was, I mean, at the end of the day, I could not get a certification from my doctor, and therefore I could not proceed with my class 1 and class 2 medical examination as a pilot, and I could not fly because of it. And that totally hit a very hard blow in my career. And it was a time where I had to progress further, not just wasting my time on what has passed or passed through my fingers. So I prepared myself, and I still knew that, you know, I was dedicated and committed to aviation. So I started applying for universities overseas for my master's in aviation. And there was this one specific university called Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology, whose program very much caught me up in my interest. And I took up this program called Master of Science in Aviation with a specialization in airworthiness. And I just accepted the offer and I went to Australia. And getting into a new country, totally greeted with new kind of people and culture altogether. The aftermath of my pilot dreams being shattered actually took toll on me when I once moved into Australia. The kind of silence and everything, I slowly got into a phase of depression and anxiety unknowingly. And I suffered a lot during that time, being in a new country, not having my dreams fully satisfied altogether. And during such a span of time, I came back to Hyderabad for a brief vacation of 3 months. And there was this lot of energy and a lot of restfulness within me. And I decided to use this restfulness, the energy, in a positive way. And I thought, I have learned so many things about aviation through my experience, because in my bachelor's time, I have done 6 different internships across various government and private organizations. And I have gained a lot of practical insight in aviation. Whenever I talk about aviation, my grandfather, my parents, and all my relatives or my peer groups always used to get excited knowing different kinds of facts and figures that actually go into aviation. And I thought that 3 months break is that one such break in my life which might change my life. And I started writing my book 101 Flying Secrets. It took me a span of 3 months to write. It was like a full-time job for me. I started off in the morning and usually ended writing my book by towards night 8 or 9 p.m. And over a course of time, after I finished writing, it took me a 6 month span of time to curate the information, correct them, edit them, and make it sound and feel simple. This book takes it in a very friendly approach. I thought of writing a coffee table book, and that is how it has come out. I have pictures, huge vivid imagery for people to understand what I have written, and I have chosen 101 different questions that common people always have about flying and airports. Everyone travels from point A to point B, but not many people are aware of what happens at the airport or what happens within an aircraft. Even if they know what actually happens, they are always hesitant in asking a question, thinking that, you know, they might sound silly or shy in front of a pilot or an engineer. So I have created a Google form, and I have spread it across to all my friends, peers, and my father's colleagues and people into industry. And I have started collecting 101 different questions from them. And I have formed the questions in such a basic manner that a small child from a school might be asking you. And after having those questions, I started writing the answers for them. Whatever you actually know from my book is something that I have learned in a very strict format of, you know, a lot of theorems, formulas, physics, and mathematics. But I have taken that pain and the pleasure of demystifying all of that and all the aviation jargon into simple words, where any person irrelevant of the field of aviation can actually open any page of the book and still understand. So as you can see, this is the book 101 Flying Secrets that I have authored. It comes in a square coffee table format. It's just 268 pages and looks a very premium finish for it. And as you can see on the cover page, this shows the fascination of a human being to fly. A man was always inspired by birds, the freedom they always enjoyed by flying. They were never bound to four-wall structures, and they always ventured in the sky, which never had limits. And looking at the birds, the human being started aspiring to fly. And that is how they started making wings and feathers, started flapping and try to fly. And thereon, it started with a small paper rocket, the aircraft, and then a balloon, the Wright Brothers glider, and then the aircraft, commercial aircraft and rockets and missiles altogether. So the theme of the book, the cover of the book actually conveys the entire theme and the efforts that people have done in the field of aviation. We have covered 101 different questions in categories like in the air, at the airport, the crew, and miscellaneous in terms of this and that. So when I randomly open a page, for example, this page, on the left, you'll always find a vivid big imagery which actually depicts the question. The question here is, why is there a hole in the aircraft window and can my window break? A lot of people have seen this question being virally circulated on the internet, and there are different forms of answer. But for sure, there is a hole in your aircraft window and it wouldn't break for sure. This small hole is known as a breather valve or a bleed valve. It helps in regulating the pressure and neutralizing the pressure between 2 to 3 different window panes that are attached to your window. And for example, just to enhance the experience about learning through the reading the book, I have also placed QR codes wherever necessary across the book. So whenever a reader actually goes through the material that I have given him, he can scan the QR code on his smartphone and he can directly be transported to a video that I predefined previously. This helps them understand the magnitude of aviation, because the things in aviation are so big and so huge that you can never satiate that interest just by words. And here is another question which asks whether do aircraft have ignition keys like cars? So, you know, you can see the level of basic questions that we start from, and we also go to some in-depth questions where, you know, do autopilots totally fly the aircraft all the time? And what is the safest seat on an aircraft? Do lightnings strike an aircraft, and are aircraft still safe after a lightning strike? Here we have another question. Do pilot and co-pilot fight mid-air, and how is it controlled? Because there have been a lot of incidences in India and across the world where pilots do have a small time of inconvenience between them, because wherever there are humans, there are supposed to be miscommunications and mistakes altogether. So here is a small brief about how actually incidences turned up to be in cockpit, where one pilot actually slapped a co-pilot, and how they dealt with the problem and safely landed the aircraft. There are so many measures in place in aviation. Aviation is very much synonymous to safety and security. So within these answers, you'll definitely find examples and different key points that you should know as a passenger as well. So here is a question: whether can people be sucked into aircraft engines? As you see, there is a man standing in front of an aircraft engine. Unfortunately, in the previous years in the Mumbai airport, there was this incident where a ground engineer was sucked into an aircraft's engine. His body was totally shattered through the engine, and it came out into a liquid form altogether. It was a brutal incident. This is lack of proper safety and understanding that actually happens on the runway. And this is the very much the reason why people are not allowed to go very close to the aircrafts while boarding an aircraft. There is a small danger zone which is marked on the engines, which people might not be aware, but engines are so powerful that they suck somewhere around 60,000 pounds of air into them, and then they blow it out behind. So the engine is very powerful, it's very hot, and it's very dangerous if you do not know how to go across to them. So as passengers, we are always asked never to use our mobile phones or laptops with internet on, or you know, mobile phones with data on. Rather, we are asked to use it on a flight mode. So there is a question whether pilots who are sitting in the cockpit can use their mobile phones or tablets or laptops altogether. As you know, the modern day aircrafts are known as glass cockpits. When I say glass cockpits, it is totally filled with LED or LCD screens which display different types of information. So a pilot always needs a handy thing to help him do the calculations or browse through different manuals. In the previous days, aircraft cockpits were equipped with papers and handbooks which weighed somewhere around in so many 20-30 kilos as well, covering up to 3,000 to 4,000 pages. But with the modern day, the pilots do carry a small tablet device which is dedicated for the aircraft, which is maintained by the airlines. It is known as an electronic flight bag. It has different charts and manuals where a pilot can easily go through during the time of need, and you can also run a few calculations whenever required. This tablet is a highly secure tablet. The airline takes the responsibility of maintaining and constantly updating this tablet with all the latest information, and this is one of the best kind of technological revolution that we have seen in the cockpits. This has reduced the workload of the pilot, as well as it also has removed so much of weight from the aircrafts as well. If I ever had to ask you which country would you think has the highest amount of female pilots in the world, I'm pretty sure most of the people whom I have asked this question have ended up answering with names of the first world country like USA or the UK or the Canada or Australia. But I am very proud and happy to inform you that India is the country which houses the world's highest number of female pilot population, starting from Kalpana Chawla, who was an astronaut, to Sunita Williams, and even you have Annie Divya, who is a world's first youngest commander of a wide-body aircraft. India has the highest number of female pilots, and there is no domination in terms of male or female, or a bias of male or female in being a pilot. Pilot is anyone who can fly an aircraft, who is informed and educated with particular skills, and a pilot need not be a male pilot or a female pilot. A pilot can be anyone. And statistically, a few years ago, I have come across the information which stated that there were 7,500 female pilots across the world, and during those days, the population of the world was 7.2 billion. So statistically, this tells me that a one female pilot is one in a million. So how fascinating is that to be? So I would call different girls of all age groups to pursue aviation, pursue flying, because there is a very high need of pilots in India, and this is the best time for females to come up, walk up, and be a part of the best office in the world, which is the cockpit. Everyone is scared about aviation specifically because of the term called turbulence. It is one of the most widely, frequently, and most misused term that we ever come across. Passengers, most of them are scared because of turbulence. They think that turbulence also can crash aircrafts. Yes, I do agree that heavy and severe turbulences, which are mostly avoided by pilots and the air traffic controllers when guiding an aircraft, can cause damage. Severe turbulence alone. But in the past 40 years history of commercial aviation, there was never a turbulence that crashed an aircraft. You are in safe hands. Pilots are due trained to control the aircraft during such severe times as well. One of the most interesting questions that children have always asked me is whether pilots sleep in the aircraft. Definitely they would sleep in the aircraft for sure, but only on long-haul flights where you have a pair of two pilots, that is four pilots, in the cockpit all the time. They take shifts on duty, and they have a controlled resting time where a pilot will actually leave the office, I mean the cockpit, after his shift has been finished and it has been replaced by another peer fellow pilot. He gets back into a bunker, which is dedicated crew resting area, and he has a regulated time where he can actually sleep and come back for duty again. So aircrafts are always known as the metal birds or man-made birds. They have all come out after aspiring from real birds which God has created. So there is a constant competition between the real birds versus the metal birds in the sky, and it becomes brutal when they both collide together. This collision between the real birds and the metal birds is known as a bird collision or a bird strike. And this has done severe damage to the aviation industry in terms of billions of dollars in repairs as well. One such famous incident is the movie Sully. This was based out of a real-time incident where a flock of birds, which were geese, went into both the aircraft engine, and both the aircraft engines failed midair. And after the engines were failed, the pilots tried to restart the engines, but everything was in vain. That was when the captain, Sully, decided to safely land the aircraft in the Hudson River. This was one of the most documented and one of the most heroic acts a pilot has ever done. And the aircraft has safely landed on the water. This is known as a ditching process, and it is not a proper landing, but it's a safety landing. And all the passengers were drawn back to safety, and this is one of the greatest stories in the aviation world. This generation is totally attached to technology, and no doubt we are all frustrated when we are asked to switch off our mobile phones while on board an aircraft. Let us just explore the reason why we are asked to do this thing. As you always know, whenever you placed a mobile phone beside a TV or a radio, you always came up with a noise, an electromagnetic interference. Just imagine if a passenger who might be thinking he's the only one person who's using the phone on board and shouldn't be an issue. We need to remember that there are almost 200 such passengers on board, and there might be many more people who are using their mobile phones. When they are using their mobile phones, the interference of the mobile phone communication with the interference of the communication of the aircraft systems on ground or with the satellite happen. And this interference gives rise to a different communication distortion in the cockpit, as well as a deflection in various parameters in the cockpit. So this has been the biggest cause of concern for a lot of aviation professionals. And that's the reason why you're asked to restrict your usage of mobile phone on board. Many of the airlines have a lot of dishes and gourmet cuisines presented on their aircraft for passengers to enjoy, but not many people actually like the taste of it. The reason being, the food on an aircraft tastes totally different from the food which tastes on ground. This is the influence of the humidity and the pressurization effects that are there in the sky at such altitudes. So there was this company and airline called Cathay Pacific, which actually came up with a particularly brew beer called Betsy, which was crafted to taste perfect at such altitudes as 40,000 feet and above. Just as the ground has become totally congested and traffic jammed altogether because of a lot of cars and bikes that are going across, there is a lot of severe traffic congestion in the air as well. But the question here is, who is the person who is responsible in actually regulating the flow of traffic in the air? As you always know, significantly, there is this significant tower in the airport vicinity, which is known as Air Traffic Control Tower, or right now known as Air Traffic Services. There are people who have a flight plan regarding your aircraft, the number of people on board, the aircraft's registration number, the destination it is starting off from, and the destination it is going to reach. And they all keep a track about the navigation of the aircraft, and they make sure that the traffic flow is regulated and there is a safe separation between various aircrafts in the vicinity. So hope you thank your air traffic controller whenever you land safe. So we all have a lot of guests coming at our home, and we definitely greet them, wish them, hug them, or even present water to them or present food as well. This is our way of welcoming people to home. But in the aviation industry, where your guests like aircrafts are too big in size to welcome, so how do we welcome aircrafts? There is this ceremonial procedure known as water cannon salute, where two fire extinguishers totally eject 18,000 liters of water in the air, making a cross arch below which the aircraft is welcomed. So this is actually done to welcome a new aircraft in a fleet of an airline, or this is to welcome an aircraft to a new destination the airline is trying to operate from. Or for example, Team India, let us say it wins a World Cup somewhere else in the world and they're coming back to home. So this is also how you can welcome them back home. And this is also done to give a farewell to pilots who have actually worked with the airline for a span of 20 to 30 years altogether. Here is a poem, A Passenger's Prayer, written by Devraj Solanki in the book. O Lord, I pray unto thee to grant my wish. Make the sky and my aircraft be like water and fish. A safe journey and a happy experience are all I wish, with a few treats thrown in, like in a gourmet dish. May the airlines treat me as a king, and I enjoy the turbulence like a swing. Beautiful lass, with sweet voice of a cuckoo bird, for company, my lord, but please, never a nerd. Enjoying good food and wine, may I have a feast. Hijacks and blasts be my worries of the least. For every mile I travel, may I get a treat, and airlines line up for me on my street. Let my ticket price always be with zero frills, and I enjoy everything with unbound thrills. May the airlines shower me with surprise steals, and for me up each other's offers and deals. Grant my pilot happy landings and tailwind, and only good things for me destined. May the crew always smile onto me and be sweet, and I have just beautiful memories to tweet. The National Institute of Mental Health, USA, states that 6.5% of global population, which roughly translates to 20 million people, suffer from the fear of flying. There is a beautiful anonymous description which is worth being recalled here. It describes reality of fear. You're not scared of the dark. You're scared of what's in it. You're not afraid of heights. You're afraid of falling. You're not afraid of the people around you. You're just afraid of rejection. You're not afraid of love. You're just afraid of not being loved back. You're not afraid to let go. You're just afraid to accept the reality it's gone. You're not afraid to try again. You're just afraid of getting hurt for the same reason. Similarly, flying is not dangerous. Crashing is. You're not afraid of flying. You're just afraid of your thoughts and how your mind dramatizes an inner fear of losing your life midair. We have managed to lift off from the ground, break the sound barrier, and whiz past at multiple times the speed of sound. Traveled to space, touched soils beyond Earth, built intelligent machines, and have overcome conditions imaginable by God and man. But the most important question is, what's next? We don't know the future, but we are here to help the future arrive.